Welcome to Cook 30. I'm Jeremy Dixon from the Revive Cafes in Auckland, New Zealand, and also author of the Revive Cafe Cookbooks. And today, I'm going to share with you some of my favourite meals from my cafes that you can cook at home. Cook 30 food is all about using whole foods. That includes plant-based proteins, whole grains, fresh fruit and vegetables, and wrapping them all together with international flavours and herbs and spices. And the best part, it doesn't need to take hours in the kitchen. I'm going to show you how you can make a delicious fat meal for your family in just 30 minutes. On the menu today, we have French lentil ragout, served on a potato and butternut mash. We have an apple and fennel slaw, and a polenta and cherry tomato mingle. And to finish off, a grape juice cocktail. Now, making a meal in a short time doesn't happen by accident. It requires a lot of planning, but once you're into the routine, it becomes easy. You want to start with a nice clear bench, chopping board, sharp knife, ingredients you need on the counter. We've got pots on the stove, boiling water in the jug, great attitude, and we're ready to go. So first thing you want to do is think ahead and think, what's going to take the longest to cook? In this case, the butternut and potato mash, we want to get that on straight away. So I'm going to get this pot fired up with the gas and pre-boiled water. So this is nearly boiling, so it's hot and ready to go. And that saves around about probably 5 minutes if you had to put cold water in that pot. And we're just going to chop up two potatoes. It's good when you get pre-washed ones because they're much easier as well. And because I'm going to mash them later, you don't need to be too careful, but just chop them nice and thin so they will cook in a relatively short time. So when you're boiling potatoes, it's much faster than roasting, so it'll probably take around about probably 15 minutes once the water gets hot. This is actually a really nice dish just with the potatoes, but just to add a little something extra special, I'm going to add some butternut pumpkin as well. So I'm going to cut it in kind of two-thirds there. This section has the seeds, which I'm going to use later, and this section doesn't, which is really great for fast cooking. So I'm just going to peel it roughly, get some of the peel off because it's mashing it. Sometimes I would leave the peel in, but because it's a mash, it's nice to have it free from too much crunchy stuff. You can get rid of that. And the pumpkin will take a lot quicker to cook, but it doesn't really matter because it's all going to be mashed up, so we're not too concerned about if the pumpkin's slightly overcooked and the potato is undercooked. So cut big wedges like that, or big strips, and then we're just going to use the knife and we're going to slice through. There we go. And that is our first job underway. So I'll put the lid on, which will help it cook a bit quicker. And we've got a full gas, and once it starts bubbling, we'll turn it down so it's simmering, which is just bubbling. Now the ragout, and this is a lovely kind of a Mediterranean vegetable lentil-y stew that just tastes amazing. So first, for any kind of a stew, is a nice onion, just to get it going. And we'll put the gas on, get that heating up. And we'll just chop it up kind of into medium dices and get the onion on. And add just a little bit of oil. We're not deep frying, just a little splash. Probably about 1 or 2 teaspoons is all you need, if that. So don't go too heavy on the oil. And we're going to throw in some eggplant, or aubergine, depending on what country you come from. We'll just kind of take off the end bits. And we're going to chop this up. Now this will really reduce down in size, so don't be too worried that there's a huge volume here. So again, just chop it into, you want to dissect your vegetables into nice controllable shapes, and it really speeds up all your chopping. And again, when you're slicing like this, you want to have your knife on the board and kind of rock it through the eggplant like that. Except when it gets too high, you can't do that. But we're slicing through, we're not cutting down. See, when you cut down, it doesn't work. We're slicing through and letting the blade do the work. So fire that in the pot as well. So this takes around about probably 20 minutes for this to become nice and cooked down and all the flavours to come out. So again, this is a job you want to do at the beginning of the meal. There's nothing worse when you're cooking a meal with all different components and you get to the time when you're about to serve and you think, oh no, I forgot to put something on half an hour ago. So always be thinking in the back of your mind, what could I be putting on now to get the meal done at the end? What in half an hour could I wish that I'm doing now? So it's all about planning. Got some zucchini or courgettes, and we're just going to chop them up and to cube them up. Again, this is all going to become like a big kind of mushy, lovely combination, so we're not too concerned about anything too pretty at all. And some red bell pepper or capsicum. Just get rid of the seeds out the middle. Like that. Should add a bit of colour. And actually capsicum or bell pepper has a really lovely flavour when it's cooked through as well. So these are kind of like a traditional, almost a ratatouille kind of a ingredient start to this dish. In terms of that French dish that has these vegetables. Look at that. So I'll just turn the gas down so it's on a bit low. We don't want it to burn on the bottom, but we just want the flavours, they'll slowly, the moisture will disappear, the flavours will intensify, and it will kind of melt down with this lovely component that will go with the lentils. I'll better put some garlic in. So let's get my garlic press. Easy way to do garlic, just throw, I've got three lovely big cloves here. Put them in the garlic press. Whoop, he doesn't want to be pressed. And squeeze them through like that. That'll join the bottom of the pan at some stage, so we don't need to mix it down too much. I'm just going to add some mixed herbs, just common average mixed Italian seasoning, just a combination of different herbs. About a teaspoon of this, just to add a bit of extra herbs and flavourings. And that'll let that kind of sit there. Make sure you come back to it every kind of couple of minutes just to give it a stir so nothing catches on the bottom. I'm using a cast iron pot today, which is really nice, but you can use a non-stick fry pan or just a normal pot. But obviously the more non-stick it is, the less oil you need and the more fun that cooking is. Oh, mushrooms. Can't forget the mushrooms. How did I do that? My wife doesn't like mushrooms, so she probably put them over there so I'd forget them. Which is great when I go out with her, because when she gets mushrooms in her dish, I end up having to share them with her, which is great. So again, these are going to melt down, so don't be too concerned about the shape. We'll just kind of cut them, cut the big ones into four, the little ones into two. And they can join the party in the blue pot. There we go. Making great progress. So now we're going to start on the salad, the fennel and apple slaw. And I don't know if you've used fennel before, but it's a really lovely kind of almost an aniseedy kind of taste of a vegetable. And it's going to make this really lovely slaw that we're doing. And a slaw is kind of what we call a coleslaw. Slaw are kind of interchangeable. Just clear the board a bit. It's always good to be nice and tidy. So we're going to use the food processor. Now this has got a slicing blade on here, and with your food processor you'll probably find all these blades in the back of the cupboard that you probably never use, but it's really, really cool for making salads. So we've got a slicing blade we're going to start with, and we're going to take the fennel, we're going to chop the end off, not going to use that, and we're going to cut this off about here. I'm going to reserve a few of these little kind of stalky bits here just to put on as garnish at the end, so we'll put those to the side, and we're just going to start processing this. So just basically put it through, and there you have instantly some lovely shards of fennel, which smells great. We're just going to add a big chunk of white cabbage. So I'll just cut it up to a size that can go in here. Oops, the top isn't on, I better do that. That's better. I'm going to force it through here. Our next ingredient is apple. So I've just got an apple, I'm just going to cut it, the core out, and this will go, just this lovely sweet apple and the fennel, just the flavours that just go together lovely. Put it through there. Lovely, a little bit of the red apple as the apple comes through. Our next ingredient is carrot. So I'm not a big believer in peeling vegetables if you don't need to. These are in reasonable condition. Give them a good chop off. Okay, let's change the blade. This is a slicing blade, so we want a grating blade for the carrots. So get that one and put a grating blade in. Be careful of the blades, they're quite sharp. And put it back on again. I'm just going to put these carrots through. And there you have instant huge amounts of salad. Got a few bit of carrots at the top, but that's okay. I'm going to pour this straight into a bowl here and mix it. And to make a dressing, I'm just going to just pour some of these ingredients over. So I'm going to pour some maple syrup over for about a tablespoon. I'm going to pour, squeeze some lemon juice over it. I'm just going to, oranges, orange juice, that's right. Some orange juice. So we're going to squeeze this. Pour it over there. Going to put a little bit of olive oil. A little bit of salt. And just going to grab a spoon and just mix it through. And this, the apple and the fennel and the carrot just all go together really nice. And the cabbage, of course. Look at that. The lovely slices of apple. And also add a little bit of baby spinach just to give it some greenness. You can get this from the supermarket like this, which is great. And some mint. So I'm just going to chop this mint up. So as you can see, lots of lovely flavours in here. Looking fantastic. So what we'll do, we'll just basically plate that up on a nice platter and probably put another drizzle of maple syrup on top, and that salad is finished. If you've just joined us on Cook 30, we are cooking a French lentil ragout, and we're going to be serving it over this lovely potato and butternut mash. We have an apple and fennel slaw and a polenta and cherry tomato mingle. And to finish off, a grape juice cocktail. So everything is going well to plan. So we're going to start with the polenta, and you can get polenta as a flour and use it in your cooking, or you can buy it pre-packaged in one of these things here where it's pre-cooked and in lovely little slabs, which is a lovely size to use for our salad. So we're going to open this, there's a little bit of water in there, and just cut off the wrapping. And we're just going to cut it into little cubes, which we're then going to fry. So just slice it like that. And then we're just going to get the little slices, cut down like that, and into cubes. Same with this one. So you only need about half the pack of this one. We don't need huge amounts. So we're just going to grab this and put it into the pan. Better turn it on. And this will just cook up nicely. I'm going to add a little bit of olive oil, just to help it go around, so probably a couple of teaspoons, not too much. And a little bit of salt, just to help it come along. It's probably about half a teaspoon. Just gonna give that a bit of a stir up. So a couple of minutes of that, it'll just kind of have a nice flavor, get slightly crispy. Whoops, a little bit's jumped into the ragout. And we'll get that underway. We're also gonna add some asparagus to this. Just have a quick clean up of the board. And we're going to add about this much asparagus. We're going to break off the end, well, this much, the ends where it's all woody. Just a you just break it in half, it snaps normally where the woodiness is. There we go. And we're going to just cook this. Oop, these ones don't want to play. We're going to cut this in just little strips like this and give these guys a little bit of a fry up with the polenta as well. Just add a little bit of extra colour. Now we'd better do what's coming up next, the ragout. This is looking lovely and soft. And we're going to start adding more ingredients. So we've got some lentils here, some canned lentils. You can cook your own lentils if you want. Let's just get them out here. So 2 cans of lentils, or around about 3 cups of cooked lentils. And we're going to make a little kind of a sauce to go with it, to thicken it up. And we've got basically a cup of cold water, and it must be cold. And we're going to use arrowroot, which is a really nice thickening thing to use. You can also use corn flour as well, but I like arrowroot because it just seems to work better. So we want around about 2 teaspoons. We're going to stir that around until it dissolves. It's quite quick. If you use hot water to start with, this will instantly set and go gelatinous, kind of jelly-like, which you don't want. We're just going to add some soy sauce, which will give a lovely dark colour. So we want around about 2 tablespoons of soy sauce. This obviously adds saltiness as well. And I'm just going to add a little bit of sweetness, a little bit of honey, just to get a little bit of sweetness, obviously helps bring through. If you don't like things sweet, you can leave that out. I'm just going to pour it through into the ragout like that. And this will, if you look really closely, will start to thicken up and provide a really nice thick texture. So yeah, arrowroot is great to add thickening to any kind of curry or stew, so it's a great ingredient to have on hand. You can't thicken up stuff that's really, really runny, or else just kind of, you can kind of tell it's been thickened, but just this amount with this kind of ingredients, it works quite nicely. So I'll turn up the heat a little bit, and as soon as that arrowroot kind of gets activated with the heat, it just thickens nicely. Look at that. Smells good. So that's essentially done. Obviously we'll garnish it with something before we put it on the table. But it's looking great. Now this polenta is coming on nicely. As you can see, it's starting to bubble away. And now I think we'll go on to the potato and the pumpkin, which I think is looking reasonably ready. So we'll turn that off. I can tell that's nice and... Just give a bit of a poke around. Yep, no, nice and... You can tell it's come apart. I'm just going to drain this in a colander, which I've put in the sink already. And then I'm just going to put it back in this pot and mash it in the same pot. No sense in using a different, whoops, bit of water there, and using a different pot. It just adds more dishes. And we're just going to grab this potato masher and just mash it like that. Now you don't want to mash it so it becomes kind of a yellowy colour. You still want to make sure you can see the difference between the potato and the pumpkin and the butternut. So just a slight one. We're going to add probably around about 1/2 cup. I've got some cashew milk here. You get some amazing milks these days. You can get oat milk, rice milk, soy milk, cashew milk, almond milk, walnut milk, hemp milk. They're just amazing. And again, we're just going to mix it round. So it's a nice creamy kind of texture. Look at that. And just a little bit of salt, so probably want around about 1/2 teaspoon. And I'll just chop up some Italian parsley as well. And we're just going to chop this relatively finely and mix it through. So there's no huge amount of flavours in this dish. It's a kind of just the pumpkin and the potato and the milk and the salt and the parsley kind of just do the job. So not every dish has to be hugely flavoured. Let's give it another mix round like that. Don't overmix it. I'm just going to serve it on this nice white dish. Grab a spoon. And oop, the ragout is heated up now, I think. I'll just give it another little final stir around. As you can see, it's glistening with that lovely arrowroot there. Lovely and shiny. So we're just going to pour this in to here. I should probably just pour it in like this. Just let things fall naturally, let gravity do the work. Oops, I can wipe that off later. And later we'll just add a little bit of parsley before we serve, just to make it better. So that dish is effectively finished, and it's a really nice base to serve it on. So something like a ragout or a hot pot like this, you traditionally serve on rice or couscous or even quinoa, but it's really nice to have something different, like a nice pumpkin and potato mash. Okay, these guys are going well, look at that. That polenta's just, it's already pre-cooked, so it doesn't need to cook much, it just needs to just kind of brown and just soak up a little bit of oil and salt. Looking good. So we're going to use a little nice blue dish today for this, and to go with it we're going to use some cherry tomatoes. So I'll just pour those in there, just like this. If you can with tomatoes, cherry tomatoes are lovely because they kind of hold their shape. They come in brilliant colours, you get orange and yellow and red these days, so make sure you go for lots of lovely different colours. And this here, I'm just going to pour over there, I'll just try a little bit. Not bad. It does have a very, you know, it's a corn taste, it's a polenta, but it's a very mild and it's not an offensive taste, it's a very nice taste to have. I'm just going to pour it over there, turn off the gas, I'm just going to stir it through. That. And that's just a nice little mingle of the polenta and the asparagus and the tomatoes. Just a nice little side dish that's very simple to make and very, very quick. This is a lovely cocktail mix I'm about to show you. So we'll start with a carafe or a jug full of some ice. And we're just going to mingle together some lovely juices. So firstly, there's some dark red grape juice. So I'm going to put some in there. Look at that. And I'm going to add some pomegranate juice as well. And it's just nice to have something that's kind of just fresh fruit juice and not, you know, not all carbonated and full of unnatural sugar. So these are 100% fruit juices. There's no extra sugar in them, they're just 100%. So make sure you buy juices like that. I'm just going to add some sparkling mineral water. And this is just a lovely, refreshing mix, because by itself those grape juices are quite strong. And we're just going to poke on the top a little bit of mint, just to give it a bit of colour. And that will mingle around and become a really nice kind of grape juice pomegranate mix, which is really, really nice. People often ask me where I get my recipes from. And when I did my first cookbook around about probably 5 years ago now, and I never thought I'd do any more than one cookbook. Now I've got 6 cookbooks. It's just amazing. And I don't know where the recipes come from. But basically how I create recipes is often I'll just wander through my produce store and say, hey, that's not quite a nice vegetable, and I'll actually kind of start building from there. So I'll start with one particular vegetable and just kind of add things on that go with it. So that's kind of one way I do it. I often like taking an unhealthy dish that is people consume a lot and people love, take out all the unnatural ingredients, all the unhealthy ingredients and sugar and white flour and chocolate and all those type of things, and replace them with natural ingredients and come up with an easy way to make them. And that's one of the things I love doing with great dishes, that to, you know, so you can have the things you love, but not, you know, your health is not going to suffer because of them. And over the years I've had about probably 6 chefs at Revive in my cafes, and it's quite amazing, every single chef has kind of added to the Revive style of cooking. My first chef was very, very good at presentation and colours and garnishing. My second chef was very good with flavours and herbs. My third chef was really good with efficiencies and building in faster ways of doing things. And my fourth chef was, well, really good at everything. So, you know, all my chefs have kind of contributed to the Revive way of doing things. And originally, I thought I might go to chef school before I started Revive, but I ended up not going, because when you go to chef school, a lot of the stuff you learn there is all about, you know, matching wines, putting as much sugar and fat and unhealthy stuff into meals as you can, a lot of different cuts of meat, desserts and pastries. And I was like, well, if I'm going to do a healthy cafe, there's actually not much stuff here that I can learn. I mean, there's still some great stuff you can learn in chef school, but I really relied on learning from my chefs with the limited amount of healthy ingredients we have to kind of create the Revive style of food. And that's kind of what comes through these shows and through my cookbooks. So yeah, I suppose if you want to learn to make dishes, kind of pick them up from my cookbooks, try with some healthy start of different vegetables, and you get underway. And before long, when you're kind of trying new things, you come up with new tasty dishes. So I think everything's pretty much done. We better put a bit of cilantro as a garnish onto the ragu. So I've just got some nice cilantro here. Always wrap your herbs in a wet paper towel to keep them nice and fresh. And we've got the drink finished, and everything is ready for the table. And that's what you can produce in just 30 minutes. The lovely pumpkin and potato mash, the polenta, we've got the apple and fennel salad bursting with flavours, and the lentil ragu. Make sure you try some of these whole food ingredients at home. As you can see, it doesn't need to take long and is not that difficult. And I guarantee you'll feel much better with energy and vitality with all this healthy food. Thank you for joining me today on Cook 30, and I look forward to seeing you next time.